if you will take a second, those little blue things are going around where you can register your attendance. We'd like for you to do that if you can. If you're brand new, even if you're not brand new here, there's a gift, a CD inside there. You're welcome to take that. What else? Maundy, Thursday is coming up. There'll be services here Thursday night. And Easter, we will have a normal 11-11 celebration in this building for Easter at 11-11 or thereabouts. And any more announcements? Or?
Yeah, one other thing.
He's got a mic.
Yeah, one other thing, too. I know that a lot of you have received an email announcement about the special party for Charles that's happening at Jim and Daphne Mullins' house on the 26th. So two things. First of all, if you didn't get an email, we are trying to update our email files here because a lot of folks are not getting some of these emails. So we want to make sure if you didn't get an email this week that was sent out as a reminder, then let us know. Let Marianne in the back know. We want to make sure we get your email. The other thing, it is at 1008 West Belknap on the 26th Saturday, and it's from 7 to 9, come and go, Jim and Daphne Mullins' house, and so we hope you all can be there. And then we'll have addresses and whatnot passed out next week, so you don't need to write that down for now, but just mark your calendars.
Let's stand and we'll say a prayer together. had a wonderful gift this morning from Amanda and Caroline. We haven't used sage in here in a while. It's one of the sacred herbs of native folk. I quit using it because people would complain down the hall that somebody was smoking pot. But it seems appropriate for this morning, maybe just because this is probably the most sacred in that tradition, and it's supposed to smudge you up a little bit. And by smudging you up, it's really about kind of getting rid of some of that stuff that you get a little too pretty about. There's a wonderful story about a woman who went to Australia and got invited into the outback with Aborigines to receive an award, she thought, for the work she had been doing with inner city Aborigine youth. And when she arrived where she was supposed to go, there was a fire going, and these ladies said, you'll need to take your clothes off. And they gave her rags to put on, and then they smudged her up really good. And she said, when it finally seemed like there was nothing left that was not smoky, they walked around to the other side of this cattle barn, and there was the whole tribe assembled. And instead of giving her a word, the leader stood up and said, come with us. And she ended up on walkabout with the tribe for about 3 months. Her book about that is kind of one of those interesting stories of discovering something about life that could be seen in a whole different way. And maybe that's why we're here. Who knows what journey you're about to embark on? Let's pray. Holy One, as we begin in this moment to see through the veil of the illusions that we are all such separate individuals, to recognize instead the unity, what happens for one does happen for all of us, that the least and the lost are on their way to the kingdom. Holy One, somehow in these moments may we arrive at that portal and discover that doorway to the life as it was always imagined somehow. So we pray. Amen.
If you would please stay standing and sing this song with us. And if you did bring an offering, this is a perfect time to take it to the altar. Let's sing together right now.
You may be watching from a safe distance. You may be so you can taste the blood. You may have headed for higher ground. You may be drowning in the flood.
Go, baby.
No matter what you do,
you run to her with open arms.
take a moment and offer each other signs of peace, would you?
Listen along. While they were eating, he took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them, "This is the blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Truly I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new." When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them, "You will all become deserters, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee." Peter said to him, "Even though all become deserters, I will not." Jesus said to him, "Truly I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times." But Peter said vehemently, "Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you." And all of them said the same.
We're standing at the cross, day and night divide. It takes all of your heart to keep the light alive. And the darkness seems so endless until the dawn arrives. We'll hold a spot between us and keep the light alive. Look at the land. Trees are bare as bones. The chill is coming on. All the summer birds have flown. But if the winter coat you'll wear is worn a bit too thin, then let me stand between you and the howling wind. We're standing at the cross. Day and night divide. It takes all of your heart to keep the light alive. And the darkness seems so endless until the dawn arrives. We'll hold a spot between us and keep the light alive. 'Cause these are the times. Tribe's strongest souls. You draw the curtain back, then you see the bitter cold. Well, what if the candle that you hold is grown a bit too dim? Then let me stand beside you till the sun pours in. Till the dawn arrives, we'll hold a spot between us and keep the light alive.
I invite you, maybe just close your eyes for a moment and let this be a part of that time where we just center the busy mind, the busy chattering monkey mind that is always analyzing. Maybe bring your attention instead to your toes or to your breathing. We spend so much time filled with images, bombarding us from the outside, and sometimes running away with us on the inside. Maybe just to be still is a way to open ourselves to this moment. Not the moment to come, not the moment in the past. In the native tradition, we are hollow bones through which the spirit flows.
When you look in a mirror, you see yourself, not the state of the mirror. The flute player puts breath into a flute, and who makes the music? Not the flute, the flute player. Whenever you speak praise or thanksgiving to God, it's always like this dear shepherd's simplicity. When you eventually see through the veils of how things really are, you will keep saying again and again, this is certainly not like we thought it was.
I want to share with you a few thoughts this morning about the passage that Terry read for us. And, you know, this is Palm Sunday. In the sanctuary, the children are coming in waving palms. There might even be like a donkey coming down the aisle. Not sure. Okay, I'm sure. There's not. The story of Palm Sunday, you know, is one that is often celebrated in this way. You know, there's something about that story, Jesus riding in to town on a donkey. Nothing particularly fancy about that. For someone who had been seen as such a leader, such an amazing leader, the idea that he would be coming into town on a donkey. John Dominic Crossan suggests in his book, God and Empire, that this is an intentional farce meant to be seen as a contrast to the Roman authority. You know, if you think about, just kind of imagine Jerusalem, and in one gate, here comes Jesus on a donkey, and at the other end, here comes the Roman battalion with their stallions. The symbol of power and authority and might, in some ways, kind of being made fun of at the other end of town. Maybe he and Walter Wink are wrong when they suggest there's a little bit of street theater going on with the people participating. But Jesus probably knew it wasn't going to fly with the authorities. It seems pretty obvious if you look at where things go from that moment that it goes pretty fast downhill. And the rest of what is celebrated this week as Holy Week, Maundy Thursday, Good Friday, Easter, are all a part of a story that now we put in context, but I try to imagine what it was like. If we read the story and imagine what it must have been like for people there at that time. Here's a guy who has said some things about life that are dramatically different from the culture, a paradigmatic shift. The rules and the laws will be kept, but love is more important than the laws. Love is more important than the laws. Love is more important than the power. Forgiveness and grace and mercy more important than judgment and justice. Wow. He might as well be riding into town right now. You know, somehow this message must be spoken over and over and over again, it seems like. Somehow, for us to be able to identify with this message that, guess what, you may want justice, and you may want power, and you may want a lot of control, but where will that leave you in the end? Where will that leave you? And more importantly, where will that leave everybody else? What if I am the vine, you are the branches? What if there is this unity that connects all of us? What would it be like to discover at the end of the most powerful life, having won the most judgments, having been without mercy or generosity to so many others, to discover that everything you did simply robbed from yourself? So closely identified you had become that all of what we do as a connected group of beings, that everything is a part of this web of relationship. Scientists may be discovering that. But the mystics and the great spiritual teachers have been talking about it for ages and ages. We just kind of have a hard time figuring out what to do with it. Because it sure seems like when someone causes harm, that, you know, retribution is in order. It sure seems like it looks good to have your act together, and often that means having a lot of money. It sure seems like a better way to live, to have the reins of power rather than to be trampled under the feet of those stallions. Maybe it takes some brokenness. Or maybe, as Peter Mayer said in one of his songs, sometimes to reach the highest place, you have to fall. You got to fall. You have to somehow lose it. Fritz Perls said, lose your mind and come to your senses. Sometimes we have to somehow let go of this indoctrination into power and control and domination to be able to find the heart and rediscover how life can be so much better in this connection. When I was in college, I played music to play my way through college and pay my way through college. There was a lot of playing, too. But as I was doing that, I encountered a singer-songwriter named Mark Gray, and he invited me to come to Nashville and write with him. Mark had written some big hits. No, he hadn't. He hadn't yet. He wrote them while I was with him, and I didn't get my name on them. He wrote Take Me Down for Alabama, and he wrote The Closer You Get for Alabama, and he had some big hits in the early 80s. So he invited me to come to Nashville and write with him because he heard me playing in a place in Shreveport. And I remember being kind of up there in that Nashville scene. I slept at a publishing house on Music Row. I was pretty broke because I was just finishing college. And the name of this place was, the publishing house is called Face the Music. It was named after the dog whose name was Face. And lots of big people came and went through those doors. And I remember sitting with Mark at the piano one time. We were trying to write a song, which back in those days could make you very rich and very famous if you could write one song, one hit song. And to write a hit song was to follow the formula. You had to do just the right kind of song. It had to have verse, chorus, bridge, chorus. Seems like we've done a couple of those today. And you had to have a hook. We would sit up for sometimes 48 hours at the piano trying to come up with the hook. And if we didn't find the hook after about 24 hours, we were down the street at Tree Publishing House or some other publishing house trying to find the hook. Because you had to have the hook. And even if you got three other guys' names on the song, you were going to have a hit better if you had the hook. So you might as well not waste the last 24 hours and find somebody else who could figure out the hook. And that's the way the Nashville songwriting scene worked. It was all about trying to write that hit. And yet what I found over and over again in that scene was, it's kind of like, you know, it could be really fast and really rich. It was like donuts just out of the grease, covered with frosting, sweet, but pretty much empty calories. As Harry Chapin once said, you know, he, through that period of the 80s, he said, I never could quite figure out how to fit in the music scene. It seemed like all about kind of look at your navel and say boogie and try to get some sense of meaning out of that. But I remember sitting at the piano at one point and I said, Mark, how did you get into this? How did you get into this? And it turned out that Mark had been invited by somebody to play, and he at some point had ended up in one of the big studios And there was this big grand piano. And he sat down at this piano that had been played by many, many of these famous, famous people. And he sat down to play. And the song that came out as he began to write went something like this. He said, "This old piano, it's made some people cry. It's made some good loves die. I reckon I know why. 'Cause when he reached the top of the mountain, I'm sorry, when he reached the end of the rainbow, there was no pot of gold. And when he reached the top of the mountain, he had no one to hold." I think about that from time to time. I think about the difference between this desperate sense of needing to be famous for some reason, for what? To have power and wealth, for what? There's nothing wrong with power and wealth. But for what? Otherwise, it's just empty calories. However sweet. Every moment that we live is lived in some context. There's a lot of talk right now in the spiritual world and the communities that want to talk about living in the now, Eckhart Tolle, being in the now, be present, be here now. Being here now is always in some sense of context. We continually experience this moment with the meaning that we have built in our lives. What are you building? What are you growing? How are you experiencing each moment? How do you make meaning out of it? Whatever it is, whatever you rehearse, is the meaning you experience in the moment. Whatever you do over and over again, we're ritualizing creatures. And two people can walk into the same place, into the same meadow, under the same sunshine or rain, and have entirely different meaning and experiences because of who they've been and what they've rehearsed in their own lives, right? Maybe it's time for us to find ways to begin to rehearse a way of living that I think Jesus kind of understood. I think he understood it as we are all people on our way somewhere. I don't know where you come from, but you've been shaped by that. My job is not to judge that. Judge not, lest you be judged. And when harm happens somehow because of those differences between us, how many times should I forgive? So many. And maybe the more we live into this idea of unity of all of us, maybe that's something we could practice. What would it be like to look into someone else's eyes, even a stranger, even somebody that you've never met, and practice seeing them with a sense of we are actually connected. We are more connected than appearances might suggest. What happens to you does impact me, is important to me. Something about the way the early Christians who were following Jesus always struck me, because they would gather and they would hold these love feasts. Maybe it was kind of the early thing that became the Eucharist, the communion service, as the church began to create sacraments that could be repeated. But in the early days, imagine the followers of Jesus after his death gathering together, maybe not even knowing about the story of Jesus breaking the bread, maybe not even knowing about that story of him taking the cup. Maybe just knowing that there's something between us that has to be acknowledged and celebrated and rehearsed, so that the more we practice this understanding of living in this unity, maybe we begin to even see our enemies with love. Maybe even see through the veil of the polarization in our society. Maybe see those who have been trodden down as people who also deserve our love and support. Maybe practicing that and celebrating that is what they were doing with these early love feasts. So this morning, I want to invite you to share in a love feast. It's open to anybody. And I invite you to just, as you consider how you might want to participate in this, draw upon your own memories of what is true and loving in your heart. Maybe draw from your own experience of what the whole story of Jesus means to you, where it has touched your life, where his life still kind of lives on in you. Maybe it's just a memory of someone who loved you so well that you found a certain sense of freedom, of wholeness, that you never quite knew until that moment. You know what I'm talking about? Someone who allowed you to be exactly who you were and loved you anyway. Do you have a memory about that? If you could bottle it and practice it every day, whatever that memory is, if you could live through that, always showing it, always trying to show it, how would the world be? What would change in your world if you could live that out, that moment that you felt so loved, that moment that you new grace. So this morning, Tom and I are going to share with you and break the bread. And we're going to invite you to come forward and to take a piece of bread and to consider whether you want to be sweet or savory. Because Tom brought honey, and I brought oil with Parmesan and herbs. You have your choice. And there's, if Marianne would bring the stack of napkins forward in the most ceremonial way that she can. They are sitting on top of the thing. I think not. I think. So our only caution is honey is sticky and oil spots. So take good care. So I'm going to take a piece of bread. I want to share this with Tom because my experience of the last 12 years of kind of sharing in this journey with Tom has been so amazingly rich and sweet. And what Tom has brought out of me and created for all of us is such a gift, and I give this to you with love for who you are to me, and how proud I am to think of you carrying on in this service, because you have such gifts. And I want to invite you, if there's someone here that you want to share love with, that maybe is a stranger, invite you to maybe to offer those gifts to each other.
And I want to share also with Charles. And I'll have to do this before I can break the bread because I only have two hands here. But I would like to share from the oil and spices because you have always brought the edge to me. And you have always given me that permission to think outside the box and have brought so much of that to this place as well. And I'll always cherish that.
Thank you.
And celebrate that with you.
Yeah, thanks. Set this down so I don't make a mess. Thanks. Now, this does not have to be somber. I'm talking with my mouth open. As we found during our celebration of foot washing, this is not about some kind of mood. It's about love. Love has all kinds of moods. Joy. Sometimes sadness, but it's a gift. Remember your gift. Remember your gift of love. So I invite you to come as you feel.
My life goes on in endless song. Above earth's lamentation, I hear the real.
Bless you, my dear.
The gift of life.
Yeah.
I'm going
to fix it. A new creation through all the tumult and the strife. I hear its music ringing. It sounds an echo in my soul. How can I keep from singing? No storm can shake my inmost calm. While to that rock I'm clinging. Since love is Lord of heaven and earth, how can I keep from singing? Tyrants tremble in their fear and hear their death knell ringing. When friends rejoice both far and near, how can I keep from singing? In prison cell and dungeon vile, our thoughts to them are winging. When friends are shame and undefiled, oh, how can I keep from singing? No storm can shake my inmost calm, while to that rock I'm clinging. Since love is Lord of heaven and earth, oh, how can I keep from singing? so tired I can't see. Standing on the edge of something much too deep. It's funny how it feels so much I cannot say a word. We are screaming inside, oh, hallway, we can't be heard.
Sometimes I feel the fever on Sunday stinging clear, and I can't help but ask myself how much I let the fear take the wheel and steer. It's tripping me before, and it seems to have a vein haunting my soul. Lately, I'm beginning to find that I should be the one behind the wheel. What happened to my love things I've been in? With open arms, open eyes, yeah. Chance to be one of the high. Well, I choose water over wine and hold my own and dry. It's tripping me before, and it seems to be the way that anyone else gets around. Ah!
this time I'd like to ask you guys to sing this chorus with me a couple of times. Y'all cool with that? Okay, here we go. Here it comes.
Whatever tomorrow brings, I'll be there with open arms and open eyes, yeah. Whatever tomorrow brings, I'll be there. I'll be there.
Keep on.
Whatever tomorrow brings, I'll be there. Open arms and open eyes, yeah. Whatever tomorrow brings, I'll be there. I'll be there.
Keep on, yeah.
Whatever tomorrow brings, I'll be there. With open arms and open eyes, yeah. Whatever tomorrow brings, I'll be there.
Let's just take each other's hands. We'll say a prayer before we go. Through all this journey of hellos and goodbyes, of struggle, of justice, and love, and peace, and forgiveness, for all of the memories that we have of pain, and of pleasure, and of joy, and of sadness, the journey is such a gift. We give thanks. Give thanks, especially for those who see through this illusion of separateness, to know that it's for us all, that the power or the wealth or the capacity for art and gift are nothing unless they're for something. So for the journeys to come, Holy One, may we find a way to practice this vision, this way of seeing every day. So whatever tomorrow brings, we can really be there. So we pray. Amen.
Quiet moment, I've got to